say little things like, oh, maybe we'll put a happy little tree right over here. He lives over there. Or there's no such thing as mistakes. They're just happy little accidents. Cute little sayings like that. But anyway, I don't know how. I'm just now finding out about these theories. I am super late. Basically, the theory states that Bob Ross, our sweet, innocent, gentle Bob Ross, could have possibly been a serial killer. Listen. So, sometime after Bob Ross's passing, people started to do a little research on his paintings and stuff, right? Well, at some point, someone discovered that one of Bob Ross's paintings, Happy Little Accidents, the landscape in that painting looked eerily similar to a real-life crime scene. At this crime scene, the half-eaten bodies of his remains were found in his house. To add to this, the remains were dated, and turns out they were from Ben Franklin's time, meaning whoever those remains belonged to, they were definitely living at the same time as Benjamin Franklin. What are the odds, right? Now, aside from him being a cold-blooded killer and stashing the bodies in his basement, another theory suggests that the bodies were actually placed there by one of Ben Franklin's friends, William Hewson, who allegedly ran some type of anatomy school out of Ben Franklin's house, they say. Now, this theory is actually on the BenjaminFranklinHouse.org site itself. Apparently, William Hewson was the son-in-law of Ben Franklin's landlady at the time. At some point, William opened his own little anatomy school out of Ben Franklin's house. So I guess whenever they got finished studying bodies in class, they would just stash them in the secret room afterward. But then you have to think, back then, it would have been kind of hard to legally get your hands on dead bodies like that. Especially since anatomy really wasn't studied all that much just yet at that point. No bodies were being donated for research and studies like they are today, you know? So that meant that they would have had to rob graves, which is very illegal, and sneak the body over into Benjamin Franklin's house in this case. And instead of taking the bodies back out after they were done studying them to keep from getting caught, they just buried the bodies inside the windowless room in the basement. Y'all, the air conditioner just came on. Sorry. But yeah, Benjamin Franklin obviously would have known about this illegal activity going on in his basement, but William was his friend, so he let him do it. I think that the anatomy school theory sounds more like it than Ben Franklin being a serial killer. But who actually knows? Anything is possible, right? Let me know what you think. So, how do you feel about reincarnation? Do you think it's really a thing? Like something that really happens? Just in case you don't know what that even is, reincarnation is defined as a person or animal in whom a particular soul is believed to have been reborn, or a new version of something from the past. So basically, say someone passes away, and then a new little baby comes along into their family, and this new baby may look scarily similar to the person who passed away, act scarily similar to them, or be interested in the same things that the person who passed away was interested in. It may seem like this little baby is the exact same person as the other family member. When this happens, people believe that reincarnation has occurred. They believe that the deceased person's actual soul has kind of been transferred, if you will, into the body of this little baby. Like, this baby is the deceased person. I hope I'm making sense. I can't really say that I do believe in reincarnation, and I can't say that I don't either. It's kind of one of those things where I haven't seen it for myself, so I'm kind of like, you know? So, I don't know if you've ever heard of the Pollock sisters, but their story is probably one of the most popular reincarnation stories out there. And if all of this story is true, I think it's rather amazing. Spooky, but amazing. So, the story surrounds these two precious little girls, two sisters. There was Joanna, who was 11 years old, and there was Jacqueline, who was 6 years old. They were living with their parents in a small town in England, and one day in 1957, both Jacqueline and Joanna were killed in a car accident,
Our dick.
on inside the office. The AC was running. Plus, her book was sitting on her desk as if she had been reading it that morning. The book was allegedly open to a page that included a very violent scene where someone was being abducted at knife point. I thought that was really eerie, but keep listening. Nothing in the office was disturbed. There was no sign of forced entry, no sign of any type of struggle. Cynthia was just gone, and her car keys and her purse were gone as well. Cynthia was never seen again after that day. No one knew what happened to her. But get this, after her disappearance, police got word of some rather disturbing things that happened prior to Cynthia's disappearance. 10 months before she disappeared, someone had written, "I love you, Cindy," on a wall near her work. By the way, Cindy is actually Cynthia's nickname, and whoever wrote this, they initialed it GW. I'm sure it really freaked Cynthia out when she first saw this, especially since she didn't know who GW could have been, on top of having those nightmares about being abducted and killed. I would have found that creepy myself. Anyway, this message stayed on that wall for 6 whole months before it was covered up. But then, just a couple of weeks after it was covered, it was written up there again, I assume by the same person. So when the police learned about this incident after Cynthia was reported missing, they started looking into people with the initials GW. One of these people would actually be a maintenance man who worked at the office that Cynthia worked at. His initials GW. He worked at the same place that she worked at, so he could have fallen in love with her after seeing her every day, you know? He had keys to access the office whenever he needed. He could have come into the office that morning without Cynthia being alarmed at all. Could have taken her away somewhere, locking the door behind him with his own key. Makes sense. But police never found any evidence of him being connected to her disappearance. He was clear. Later on, they would find the person who was responsible for writing "I love you, Cindy" on the wall. But it wasn't believed that this person had anything to do with her actual disappearance either. Now, it is said that the day before her disappearance, she had received 2 phone calls while she was at the office working with a client. We don't know who the caller or callers were, but whatever they said to Cynthia, it made her visibly upset. Apparently, she looked scared after taking these calls, but she never did speak on what happened or what the calls were about, so Richard a message. I assume he was upset with Richard about something dealing with their illegal activities. Both Richard and Jose got charged with drug trafficking, but police couldn't prove that they actually had anything to do with Cynthia's disappearance. So, after all of that, the case is still unsolved. Cynthia is still missing to this day. We literally don't know what happened to her, and it bothers me, especially adding the fact that she kept having those nightmares. It's just so odd. I wish I knew more.